Hello children, welcome back. This is part 2 of the first lesson, that is reproduction in organisms. Before going into the next part of the lesson, first let us have a recap of the previous session. The previous session was totally about asexual reproduction. The asexual reproduction involves only a single parent, and hence the offspring which are produced by the single parent is morphologically and genetically similar to the parent. And hence we call it as a clone. And the asexual reproduction will be taking place by simple cell division. And the example for the simple cell division that happens in the protists and monerans are budding in yeast and in binary fission in amoeba. The other types of asexual reproduction which we had seen in the previous session was gonidia, that is in penicillium, and also budding in hydra, and the gemmules in sponges, and then zoospores in the chlamydomonas. In plants, we do not call it as asexual reproduction, as we call it as a vegetative reproduction, because the vegetative parts of the plant will be giving rise to the new offspring, and the vegetative propagules or the vegetative parts, the rhizome, suckers, tuber, offset, bulbs, etc. Now, let us go to the next part of the lesson, that is the sexual reproduction. As you are all aware of it, the sexual reproduction involves the male and the female gametes, which is formed by the two individuals. All the organisms in the sex, before reaching to the sexual reproduction, they will be growing to a certain age. And that phase, we call it as the juvenile phase. The period of growth before they attain maturity, we call it as a juvenile phase. And in plants, we call it as a vegetative phase. In the angiosperms, that is the flowering plants, the vegetative phase will be completing as soon as the flowers are produced by the plant. Next comes the senescent phase. The senescent phase is the end of the reproductive phase. It is not only the old age, but the end of the reproductive phase, we call it as the senescent phase. Shall I repeat it once again? There are two types of phases before an organism for an organism. One is the juvenile phase and the other is the senescent phase. Juvenile phase is a period of growth before the reproduction, and then we have the reproductive phase, and then we have the senescent phase, that is the end of the reproductive phase. Flowering in plants. Now, flowering is an important part of the plant life cycle, because after flowering only, the fruits will be developed. And there are two types of plants, as you are all aware. We have annual type of flowers and the biannual type of plants. And annual type of plants, you know that their life cycle will be only 1 year. So the juvenile phase or the vegetative phase, the senescent phase and the flowering phase, everything will be completed within a year. But in the biannual phase, you know, it completes in two years. For example, you can see rice, wheat, marigold, etc. In some plants, the flowering occurs several times in a particular season, but in some plants, flowering occurs once in a lifetime, especially in the perennial plants. For example, we have the bamboo that will be flowering after 50 to 100 years. And you would have heard about the flowers, kurunji. It will be only flowering once in 12 years. And 2008, it flowered, and next was 2016, and next will be 2030. You can see how the plants are flowering, and the whole mountain or the hill is covered with this kurunji flowers. And this scene is possible only once in 12 years. And these are the examples of the bamboos. These bamboos, after planting, the shoot system will not be developed immediately. They will be developing the root system first, and all of a sudden, the shoot system will shoot up all of a sudden. And their flowering will be taking place after 50 to 100 years. Now, coming to animals, that there are two types of reproductive cycles that is taking place in animals. Now, for example, if you take the birds, they will be laying the eggs only in the specific season. And the placental animals, they will be exhibit reproductive cycle that will be leading to changes in the ovaries as well as the hormonal level. As the reproductive cycles are different, as we have the estrous cycle as well as the menstrual cycle. The estrous cycle will be taking place in the non-primate, like the cow, dogs, rats, tigers, etc. And they will be active only in a specific season. And that is why they are called as the seasonal breeders. And menstrual cycle will be taking place in the primates, like the monkeys, apes, and the humans. And they will be active throughout the reproductive phase. And that is why they are called as the continuous breeder. What are the events that will be taking place in the sexual reproduction? This sexual reproduction will be consisting of three events. One is the pre-fertilization event, the next is the fertilization, and then the post-fertilization event. In the pre-fertilization event, there are two things that will happen. That is the gametogenesis and the gamete transfer. What is gametogenesis? Formation of the gametes, we call it as the gametogenesis. And the transfer of the male gamete to the female gamete is called as the gamete transfer. Next comes the fertilization. You must be aware of it. The fusion of the male and the female gametes, we call it as the fertilization. Next comes the post-fertilization. Immediately after the fertilization, the zygote is formed. And after the zygote formation, the development of the zygote is called as the embryogenesis. Now, let us see one by one. First, we will see about the pre-fertilization event. Under the pre-fertilization event, the gametogenesis is the main one. Gametogenesis is nothing but the process of formation of the male and the female gamete. And gametes should always be haploid. You know, these gametes are haploid because after fusion, they form into a diploid cell called the zygote. Now, these gametes are of many types. One is homogametes or isogametes. They are morphologically similar. Male and the female gametes will be similar. For example, you can see here, this is the isogametes or the homogametes, where you cannot differentiate between the male and the female. Both will be similar and it is in the type of an algae. Next comes the heterogametes. Here, morphologically, the male and the female gametes will be different. For example, you can see here, the male gamete is small and the female gamete is big in the shape of an egg. And one more example is in the human beings. Human beings also have heterogametes as the ovum is different from the sperm. That is, this is the female gamete and this is the male gamete. Then we have the anthrozoid or the sperm, that is the male gamete. This is the male gamete. And this is the egg, that is the female gamete. Now, as I was already talking about the haploid and the diploid. The diploid is always mentioned as 2N and the haploid is mentioned as only N. So, if, for example, in a human being, the cell will consist of, the meiocyte will consist of 46 chromosomes, then the gamete will consist of only half of it, that is, it will consist of only 23, that is, haploid. The same way, if the housefly is having 12, the chromosome in the gamete will be 6. And if the gamete is having 21, and then the chromosome of the cell will become 42. The same way, this table is there in the textbook. Kindly try to fill up this. Because as you know, the remaining cells which are there in the body will be having 2N, that is diploid number of chromosomes. And the gametes will be having haploid number of chromosomes. Now coming to the sexuality in organisms. Homothallic or monoecious. This is a bisexual condition in fungi and in a plant. In this, both male and the female reproductive structure are present in a single individual. That means both the male and the female reproductive structure, for example, the stamen and the pistil, will be found in the same flower. Then that we call it as the homothallic or else the monoecious. Next is the heterothallic or the dioecious. It is a unisexual condition in which the male and the female reproductive parts are found in different flowers. I repeat once again, homothallic or monoecious. It is a bisexual condition. That means both the male and female will be present in one single individual. And heterothallic or dioecious, it is a unisexual. Uni means one. That means only male or female will be present in one flower. That means both the male and female will be present in two different flowers. Now, male flower, what is the reproductive organ in the male flower? That is the staminate or the stamen, which we have called, which we usually call. And what is a female flower? It will be consisting of the pistillate, which will be bearing only the pistils. Now you can see few examples of the monoecious plant, for example, cucurbita. And for dioecious plants, you have the papaya as well as the tape. In papaya, if you would have noticed, not all the papaya plant will be giving rise to fruits. Only the female plant will be giving rise to fruits because they are different flowers. This you can see, this is the male flower and this is the female flower. So only the female flower will be giving rise to the papaya fruit. So this is a plant and it is an example for dioecious plant. And these are the date palms. These are the date palms, which has two different types of flowers which are seen in date plant. And these are the cucurbita flowers. Here also you can see two different types of flowers. One is the male and the other is the female. These are all examples for dioecious flower, where the male is in a different plant and the female will be present in the different plant. In animals, coming to animals, there is a condition called as the hermaphrodite or else the bisexual animals. That means both the male and the female reproductive organs will be present in the same animal. And the best example for that is the tapeworm, earthworm, sponges, and the leech. In this diagram, you can see that the ovary as well as the testes both are present in the earthworm itself in a single animal. This type of a condition we call it as a hermaphrodite or else called as a bisexual animal. Next comes the unisexual animals, which we commonly see in all types of animals, that is the cockroaches, the insects, the birds, the fishes, amphibians, mammals. Both the male and the female will be distinct. Their morphological structure will be totally different, and the male reproductive part and the female reproductive part are present in two individual structures. These are few examples where you can see both the male and the female animals are different. And these are examples for unisexual animals. Even the birds, this is the peahen and this is the peacock. Similarly, the other birds also, which shows the unisexual condition of the animals. Now coming to the haploid organisms. The individual having only one set of chromosomes in a somatic cell, we call it as a haploid organism. For example, monera, fungi, algae, bryophyte, they all have haploid plant body. And diploid organisms, the individuals having two sets of chromosomes in the somatic cells, we call them as a diploid organism. And examples are the pteridophytes, gymnosperms, angiosperms, and most of the animals, they have the diploid number of chromosomes. So this diploid number of chromosomes, when they form damage, they have to undergo a meiosis division that is called as the reduction division, where the diploid number of chromosomes becomes into haploid number of chromosomes in the gametes. Part of the pre-fertilization event is the transfer of gametes. In majority of the organisms, the male gametes are motile. Female gametes are non-motile. In few fungus and algae, both the male and female gametes are motile. Hence, they swim towards each other and they fuse. In algae, bryophytes, pteridophytes, male gametes will move in the water and then reach the female gametes, so that the fertilization will take place. A large number of male gametes are produced when compared to the female gametes. This is because the male gamete has to swim across and reach the female gamete. In that process, many of the male gametes will be lost or will die. So to compensate that, there is a large number of male gametes which are produced compared, that is 1,000 times more when compared to the female gamete. Coming to the bisexual self-fertilizing plants, you would have heard about pollination. So if it is a bisexual self-fertilizing plant, you know, simply just from the antelope, the pollen grains will just fall on the sigma and the fertilization will take place. But the unisexual plants, that is when the male and the female plants or the flowers are different, then they need a media like air, insects, birds or animals for the pollen to reach the stigma of the female plants. And then the transfer of the gametes will be taking place. Now next is the fertilization event. Now before this we saw the pre-fertilization event, that is the gametogenesis, formation of the gametes and the gamete transfer. Now after the gamete transfer, immediately the next is the fertilization. Fertilization is otherwise called as a syngamy, that is nothing but the fusion of the male and the female gamete. So fusion and the male, that is a sperm and the egg, will lead to a diploid cell called as a zygote. Sometimes, without the fusion of the male and the female gamete, it will be taking place, and that we call it as the parthenogenesis. It develops without fertilization. For example, honeybees, some lizards, some turkey birds, etc. They will be reproducing or giving rise to the young ones without the fertilization of the sperm and the egg, and that is called as the parthenogenesis. Only the egg will be giving rise to a new individual. Sometimes the fruits, if they don't have the seed, they are all called as the parthenocarpic fruit. How does the fertilization takes place? That is also of two types. One is the external fertilization and the other is the internal fertilization. So external fertilization, in this, the fusion of the male and the female will occur outside the body of the male or the female. For example, we have algae, fishes, amphibians. In all these, the fertilization takes place outside the body of the female, that is, maybe in the water. The disadvantages of the external fertilization: the organisms will be producing large number of gametes, and the predators, sometimes, you know, there will be other big animals which will totally destroy the eggs which are fertilized and which are left externally. And then the survival state of the offspring to the adult is very, very less. Internal fertilization will be taking place inside the male-female body. The fusion of the male and the female gametes will be taking place inside a female body. Then we call it as the internal fertilization. In plants, gymnosperms and angiosperms are the examples. And in most of the terrestrial animals, internal fertilization takes place. Next is the post-fertilization event. After the fertilization, the first cell which is formed with the diploid set of chromosome is the zygote. The fusion of the haploid male and the haploid female gamete will be resulting in the diploid zygote. So in fungi and algae, the zygote formed will have a thick cell wall, and it helps to resist the unfavorable condition. So this is the thick cell wall, and they will be inside the cyst when there is unfavorable condition. And only when there is favorable condition, they will burst open and all the other cells will be released. You would have studied this in your 11th class. I hope you remember this life cycle, aplontic life cycle, diplontic life cycle and all those. Shall we recap it once again? You can see that in this individual, for example, Volvax or Spirogyra or Chlamydomonas, or zygote is divided by meiosis to form the haploid spores, and these spores will be developing into haploid sporophytes. You see two types of life cycle will be taking place. This is the haplontic life cycle, where you will have the haploid number of chromosomes which will be taking place. After that, you have the gametogenesis, and then the fusion will be taking place, that is the fertilization, and then the zygote formation will be taking place. Again, meiosis takes place. Meiosis is nothing but reduction division, and that is why, again, the spores are formed with haploid number of chromosomes. Next is the diploidic plant. In this diploidic plant also, we have two life cycles. One is the sporophytic generation and then the gametophytic generation. In the sporophytic generation, they will be having the diploid number of chromosomes, and in this gametophytic generation, that is the life cycle, they will be having the haploid type of chromosomes. So this is haplodiplontic type, and example is the bryophytes and the pteridophytes. Here also you can see this part will be having the haploid number of chromosomes, and this part be happy having the diploid number of chromosomes, and that is why it is haplodiplontic life cycle. These all we have studied in 11th class. I think it must be in chapter 3. Next comes the embryogenesis. So the post-fertilization events consist of the zygote formation and then the embryogenesis. So what is embryogenesis? It is nothing but process of development from the zygote. From the zygote, there will be a lot of divisions that will be taking place, and they will be differentiating into an embryo. They will be forming different layers of cells, mesoderm, endoderm, ectoderm, and these layers will be forming different organs in the embryo. While embryogenesis will be taking place in the oviparous and viviparous animals. In oviparous animals, most of the embryogenesis will be taking place outside the body, that is inside the egg it will be taking place. But in viviparous animals, that is the animals that give birth to the young ones, the development, that is the embryogenesis, will be taking place inside the female body. Because of the proper embryo care and protection, the chance for survival of the young one are more viviparous than oviparous. What happens to the flower after the fertilization? Now, what fertilization changes in the flower? You know what? This fertilization, the pollen from the anther will fall on the stigma, and then they reach the ovule here, and the fusion will take place. After the fusion, that is after the fertilization, this ovule part will become into the seed, and this ovary part will become into the fruit. And all petals and other things will wither dry, and they will wither away. The ovary, can you see here, the ovule develops into a seed, and the ovary will be developing into the fruit, otherwise we call as the pericarp. Same thing we have mentioned already. And even in the next lesson, we are going to study about the sexual reproduction in the flowering plants. So in detail, we'll be studying there. You just have to know about the two words, that is the antecium and the gynecium. Antecium is the male reproductive part of a flower, and the gynecium the female reproductive part of the flower. Antecium is nothing but the stamen, and gynecium is nothing but the pistil. Stamen is nothing but you have a filament here and you have the antelope inside which the pollen grains will be produced. We will be seeing in the next lesson. These are the structure of the male reproductive organ. This is the female, this is the mother, and inside which we have the pollen grains. In the flowering plant, the zygote is formed inside the ovule. After the fertilization, sepals, petals, and stamens of the flower will wither and fall off. This, however, remains attached to the plant. The zygote develops into an embryo, and the ovules will develop into the seed, as I already mentioned. The ovary develops the fruit, which develops a thick wall called as the pericarp. This part we call it as the pericarp. That is the protective function. After this fertil, the seeds germinate under favorable conditions to produce new plants. Then we have a recap. Now in the sexual reproduction, what did we see? First, we saw that it consists of two types of phases. One is the juvenile phase and the senescent phase. Juvenile phase, till they reach the growth that takes place, till they reach the reproductive phase. And then we have the senescent phase, which is the end of the reproduction. After that, in sexual reproduction, we saw three types of events taking place. The pre-fertilization event, fertilization event, and the post-fertilization event. In the pre-fertilization event, there are two events that is taking place, that is gametogenesis, that is nothing but the formation of the male and the female gamete. Then, gamete transfer. Post-female gamete and fuses, then we call it as a gamete transfer. Then, where the male gamete and the female gamete fuse with each. Then, post-fertilization event, and here we have the zygote formation with a different number of chromosomes, and then we have the embryogenesis, that is the development of the zygote into an embryo, we call it as the embryogenesis. These are the types of fruits or the flower developing into the fruits, which we'll be seeing in the next lesson also. First kits are given, as well as there is a home assignment given. Home assignment to be written in the class work, and the work kit to be written in a separate book. $90 has been spent in our school.